The following program is being brought to you on the Voice America Business Channel. For more information about our network and to check our additional show hosts and topics of interest, please visit voiceamericabusiness.com. The Voice America Talk Radio Network is the worldwide leader in live internet talk radio. Visit voiceamerica.com. The views and ideas expressed on the following program are strictly those of the host or guests and do not necessarily reflect the views and ideas held by the Voice America Talk Radio Network, its staff, and management.
Welcome to Disabilities at Work Radio, where every week we explore issues, ideas, initiatives, and innovations involving the employment of people with disabilities. We feature employers that go beyond compliance in supporting people with disabilities in the workplace and elsewhere. We bring you prominent members of the business community, service providers, government officials, researchers, educators, and people who successfully manage their disability and careers. Join us now for Disabilities at Work.
Hello, I'm Ray Zardetto, and welcome to Disabilities at Work Radio here on the Voice America Business Network. Each week at noon Eastern Time, Disabilities at Work explores issues, ideas, initiatives, and innovations involving the workplace and people with disabilities, and discusses them with prominent members of the business, government, and disability communities. Disability at Work Radio is brought to you this week by two distinguished organizations dedicated to improving the lives of the disabled, the Kessler Foundation, and the New Jersey Division of Disability Services. And we'll talk a little bit more about each of them later on. As for today's show, if I were to ask anyone in the audience, any of you ladies and gentlemen, if you know the number one cause of death and disability for American children and young adults in this country, I wonder how many of you would know that the answer is brain injuries. In fact, the numbers are stunning. Over 3 million new cases of brain injuries occur each year. 3 million. And this has resulted in 17,000 permanent disabilities and over 12,000 deaths in children and young adults. And these figures come to us courtesy of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, and you can also find them on the website of the Sarah Jane Brain Foundation, which is a nonprofit organization dedicated to the study of brain injuries and to helping make better the lives of those with brain injuries and their families. And so today we're going to discuss the staggering problem of brain injuries with a distinguished panel of guests. So let me introduce them to you now. First, Anne Glang, a senior fellow, research professor at the Teaching Research Institute, and a research scientist at the Oregon Center for Applied Science, and Ron Savage, the president of the North American Brain Injury Society, founder of the Pediatric Task Force of the Brain Injury Association of America, and senior consultant at the Center for Neurological and Neurodevelopmental Health in Voorhees, New Jersey. Both Ann and Ron are members of the Sarah Jane Brain Foundation's advisory board. So Ann and Ron, let me welcome you to the program first.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. And rounding out the panel is Patrick Donohue, who is the founder and president of the Sarah Jane Brain Foundation. And Patrick, I'd like to start our discussion on the show today with you by asking you exactly who is Sarah Jane?
Well, Sarah Jane is my five-year-old daughter, who was born in June of 2005, and she suffers from a severe brain injury when she was just 5 days old. The baby nurse that we had hired to be with us for the first month of her life and teach us the ropes violently shook her when she was only 5 days old, breaking four ribs, both collarbones, and then causing this severe brain injury, which has left her permanently disabled and changed her life and my life and many, our entire family's lives forever. And she's my daily inspiration. What ended up happening is about a year into the daily routine of taking care of her, I started to read up as much as I could on neuroplasticity, neuroinformatics, anything my hands on about the brain. And what I quickly realized was, and by the way, I only understood about 10% of what I was reading, but what I quickly realized was how little we knew about the brain, never mind the developing brain, that as a layman, the way I describe it is we relatively know about the same about the brain as we knew about cardiology in the 1850s, that we probably know about 5% of what we'll eventually know. And then on top of that, I realized how fractured the field was, that there's no one repository of knowledge or information, and it's all over the map. And, you know, people are working in their individual silos all across the world dealing in this field. And it reminded me of the computer science field of the 1950s and 60s, where you had brilliant people all over the world working in it, but nobody knew what everybody else was doing. So what ended up happening is I fast-forward 50 years, and I started thinking, well, where are the breakthroughs occurring today in those fields? And they're all using open source principles, whether it's Wikipedia, Linux operating system. Shared knowledge is where the breakthroughs were occurring. Think of the Human Genome Project, I think, is a good example. And so I started to research to see who was using those principles in the field of neuroscience, and specifically pediatric neurology, because I figured that's where the breakthroughs would occur for Sarah Jane. And so I searched high, low, wrote, called, emailed people all over the world, and the bottom line is that nobody was using those principles. NIH started a thing called the Human Brain Project about 15 years ago, but Sarah Jane's going to graduate from Yale by the time they complete the damn thing. Uh-huh. And one of the things you'll quickly realize is that I'm not really a patient person when it comes to helping my daughter. And so that's what sparked me on, you know, the mission of starting the Sarah Jane Brain Foundation.
Yeah, I, knowing just a very little bit about what occurred, I would say, if I had to describe it, that the initial diagnosis that the doctor made of your daughter's condition when it occurred was a pretty bleak diagnosis, I think. And I'm just wondering, you know, how you reacted to it then, and then what prompted you, because I think a lot of people might have just accepted the doctor's diagnosis at that point, but what prompted you to do what you're doing now?
Well, one of the unfortunate things is one of the doctors that one of the first doctors we ran into basically tried to, you know, state that her injury from a scale of 1 to 10 was an 8, and that Sarah Jane would probably never walk or talk. And this was a child who was less than a month old. While I was fortunate enough to have other contacts that I'd spoken with, which the consensus in this field is that the answer really is that nobody knows. So I was fortunate enough to have, you know, second opinions from people basically saying that, you know, nobody really can make a prediction about a brain-injured individual. Certainly you can't make really much predictions about brain-injured children just because there isn't enough information or data, and we just don't know enough about the brain to make those type of diagnoses. And so the bottom line is the philosophy that kind of wakes me up every single day and keeps me going is that things work out best for those who make the best of the way things work out. And so that's what sparked me to, you know, continue looking and searching and trying to find more. And the reality is that what my goal is that I'm certain 50 years from now, a case like Sarah Jane, there will be tons of different types of treatments and protocols and that will exist. But I'm not interested in wasting 50 years. So my mission is really to advance what we know about the brain, and certainly advance what we know about brain injury, you know, 50 years in the next 5 years, because, right, you know, Sarah Jane is 5, and, you know, I'm not going to wait till she's 50 for the science to catch up.
And let me ask, Ron and Ann in with a couple of questions here, just wondering on a very base level here. I mean, how do we define a brain injury? I mean, how severe does the trauma to the brain have to be for it to qualify as a brain injury?
Well, let me just I'll start with a little definition thing and then have Ann really take this on. But when we talk about acquired brain injury, the acquired part is what we're talking about is from birth on. In other words, Sarah Jane was a very young child, you know, just a few days old when this happened to her. Or she could have been, you know, 11 years old, or she could have been 16 years old or 22 years old. But it's acquired after birth. This is not a developmental disability or something else. And then when we look at acquired brain injury, we break it down into two large groups. Some brain injuries are caused by an external physical force. In other words, a child is in a car crash, head hits the windshield, or they fall from playground equipment or off the deck at their house. Or maybe it's a sports injury or an assault, shaken baby syndrome. So those external physical force, something from the outside in, jarred that brain and did damage. And then we have a group of what we call internal occurrences. So you can have a brain injury because maybe the child had a stroke, or the child had a tumor resection. infectious diseases like meningitis and encephalitis and even neurotoxins like carbon monoxide poisoning. All these things can cause brain injuries.
And I mean, it's kind of a difficult thing, as Patrick was saying before, however, because the brain is probably the least understood part of the body, or certainly one of the least most understood parts of the body. And so, I mean, how do you distinguish between someone who just, you know, takes an accidental knock on the head versus someone who may have a concussion or someone who got something that's much more of a traumatic kind of brain injury? Where do we kind of draw the line between something that's not particularly serious and something that's much more of a brain injury?
I think I could tackle this one. You know, the thing that is so challenging on the positive side and the thing that is so very, very difficult on the negative side is that you have a very, very large range of effects from brain injury. So you can have a child looking, walking, talking, speaking, behaving very, very normally, and yet have some significant cognitive impairments that are very hard to see. You can have a child who looks very, who maybe has some physical challenges associated with a brain injury, but it does quite well in school, and everything on all ends of the extremes. So it's very, very difficult. And when it comes to, you know, what Ron and I are dealing with primarily is in the school setting, because that's where kids are being served, is in the schools. And when you look at brain injury in the schools, you have some very clear definitions based on special education law about who gets services and who doesn't, and that's related to the disability. So it's very complicated. There's a lot of angles and aspects to this, and I think when Patrick says where we were in cardiology in the 1800s, with this disability in the schools and in terms of services and supports, we're maybe where we were in the 70s, maybe before that even. So we have an extreme lack of awareness. We have lots of work to do.
And if I could chime in, even the nomenclature that's used to describe brain injury, I mean, the terms are used mild, moderate, and severe are basically the way brain injuries are defined, but if you take just the simple definition of a mild traumatic brain injury, the brain, which has consistency of, say, hard jello, and if you stick, you know, that hard jello in front of a car going 20 miles an hour, that's actually classified as a mild TBI. So, I mean, you know, you go stick your cell phone in front of a car going 20 miles an hour and expect that to work and function properly. Mm. And you know, so, I mean, the complexities here all over the map, and the frustration piece is that a lot of the burdens are put onto the families, you know, to make determinations about, you know, the care for their children, and it's random, and, you know, from one state to another, it's arbitrary from one school district to another, and it's a crapshoot from one doctor's office to another,
right.
And so the concept of what we started to do with the Sarah Jane Brain Foundation when we launched this is, as I saw how scattered things were, so I decided to use those open source principles, and what I came up with was, for the first time in medical history, putting all of Sarah Jane's medical records online in an open source format. And my thinking on it was, bare minimum, I'm going to get more eyeballs on her case. I'm going to get some, you know, research scientists in Switzerland at 3 o'clock in the morning, instead of watching March Madness, you know, he or she likes to look at EEGs, or some physical therapist in Florida looking at a video of Sarah Jane and suggesting a different rotation. And as we started to develop that, what happened is many of the doctors that are involved with Sarah Jane basically said to me, you know, Patrick, if you can get 50 or 100 or maybe even 1,000 families to participate in an open source initiative like that where you're sharing information and understanding, we could really advance, you know, the field of brain injury, you know, more so than any other field. And if it's successful, it could be a complete paradigm shift on how you, you know, collaborate and collect research data and share it amongst one another. And that's kind of how this whole project started.
All right, great. Well, panel, we need to take a short break at this point, and when we come back, I want to talk a little bit about the prevalence of brain injuries and also to talk about where we are in terms of research and some of the breakthroughs that we either have seen or maybe on the horizon. But we need to take a short break first, so ladies and gentlemen, stay with us. I'm Ray Zardetto, and this is Disabilities at Work Radio.
up-to-date business and financial news. Call now and get the financial information you need. 866-472-5790. 866-472-5790.
The experts are here.
Voice America Business Network. Disabilities at Work encourages people with disabilities, their families, and their supporters to patronize businesses that have earned the right to display the Disabilities at Work logo on wall plaques, window decals, or websites. By some estimates, people with disabilities control hundreds of millions of dollars in disposable income. They can use that spending power to send a message to corporate America. Become a Disabilities at Work business or a registered agency with the power to endorse supportive businesses at the Disabilities at Work website, www.disabilitiesatwork.org.
When it comes to business, you'll find the experts here. Voice America Business Network.
You are listening to Disabilities at Work Radio. We welcome questions and comments from our listening audience, which you can send to us on Twitter at Disabilities At or on our Facebook site, Disabilities at Work. Also, visit disabilitiesatwork.org. Welcome back.
Welcome back to Disabilities at Work Radio here on Voice America's Business Network. The show this week is brought to you by the Kessler Foundation and the state of New Jersey's Division of Disability Services. I'm Ray Zardetto, and today we are talking about brain injuries with a panel of distinguished representatives from the Sarah Jane Brain Foundation, a nonprofit organization, one of the largest organizations of its kind, dedicated to the study of brain injuries. And we are happy to welcome a new member to our discussion panel here, Dr. Joseph Tipas, University of Florida Professor of Surgery and Pediatrics and Chief of the Division of Pediatric Surgery at the University of Florida. And Dr. Tipas is also on the advisory board for the Sarah Jane Brain Foundation. So, Doctor, welcome.
Thank you. Good to be here. And
actually, it might be a great time to bring you into the discussion. We were talking during the first segment about some of the staggering numbers that are involved in brain injuries. Over 3 million new brain injuries are reported a year, according to the Centers for Disease Prevention. And I was just wondering if we could put that into some perspective to begin this next segment of the discussion. I mean, when we talk about the prevalence of brain injuries in this country, how prevalent are they when you compare them to incidents of, you know, major diseases like cancer, heart disease, even asthma, and some of the other well-known maladies that we have to deal with?
Well, I can answer that question in a fair amount of specifics by pointing you to the original work that was done by Sue Baker in 1975 regarding trauma as the, quote, untreated modern disease. And in that particular monograph, which was actually produced by the Institute of Medicine, she points out that when you look at the actual years of life lost from injury in general, and brain injury is obviously a major driver of that, and you compare that to the volume of dollars of research, you see that that is the one area that has the most dominance both in our country and globally as far as a cause for disability and loss of life against the paltry amount of dollars that are spent for research. The curve for, or the boxes for money that's spent in investigating AIDS or heart disease or cancer far exceeds the actual loss of years of life from those diseases. Trauma is just the opposite. Trauma is the primary killer of everybody under the age of 44, and yet has minuscule amounts of dollars that are dedicated to its research. Now, I follow up that comment by telling you that, you know, if you're diagnosed with cancer or heart disease or something like that, you obviously have reasonably objective symptoms that quickly force you to seek medical care. But there are children who are sustaining, quote, minor brain injuries, as well as those who are getting more significant injuries, who are experiencing significant anomalies in the function of their brain and in the future development of their brain that are literally under the radar and don't even manifest themselves for years after the event, oftentimes with the event being forgotten. So when you put those two things together, the short answer to the question is it's staggering in its epidemiologic pervasiveness in our society, and it's unsettlingly quiet in that there's a huge amount of it that is way under the surface that is emerging in everything from cognitive to behavioral problems to early dementia that we're just now beginning to get an even slight understanding about.
That was about a million words, but that tells it.
Yeah, but it's a very compelling story, though, because I think certainly just these numbers are stunning to me, and I would agree. It seems as though this whole situation has been underreported, no matter how you look at it. And so,
right, underreported and underdiagnosed, no question about it.
And from that point of view, I guess you could understand why the dollars haven't been there in terms of research and everything. But in terms of research, in terms of what we're seeing, where the breakthroughs now are on the horizon, and I hope I throw this out to anybody on the panel, what can we hope to see soon? What are we seeing in the way of breakthroughs in some of the research work that is going on in this area?
Well, I don't want to steal thunder from my colleagues on the panel, but that question can be answered by focusing on various and sundry elements within the area of management of this disease. And, of course, the most impressive and important vaccine against the disease of injury is prevention. We certainly are not spending as much money and effort as we should be in conveying efficiently a prevention message that enables young parents especially to do some fairly simple things that would significantly enhance the safety of the environment in which they raise their children.
And what would some of those be?
Well, I mean, for example, just the whole process of appropriate child restraint, use of helmets, safe walking programs, many of these things exist in spots throughout our country but have not been globally disseminated. And interestingly enough, a classic example, one of the papers that was discussed and presented a couple of years ago at the Injury Free Coalition, where an extensive and very expensive system of home safety and preparation and prevention for the natural disaster of an earthquake in Southern California was developed, and no one thought to remember that there's a significant amount of that population that don't speak English.
Yep.
So these are the simple things. This is the low-hanging fruit, so to speak. You walk around some of the major cities in our country and you see no sidewalks. And then you wonder why children don't cross at crosswalks. So there's a lot of just basic environmental engineering. There's a tremendous amount of educational initiative regarding, safe play, the need for exercise, things of that variety that is either not delivered because the methodology or the modality isn't there, or the ability to do it and the funding to produce an effective and compelling message is not provided. That's number one. But then, in answer to your other question, so when prevention fails and the injury occurs, over the last 25 years, we have seen a dramatic evolution in our emergency medical services and trauma systems that has enabled us to significantly improve outcome from massive and devastating injury. And some of the processes that we're learning regarding how the brain reacts to injury, things that we can do to minimize ongoing injury, various and sundry biological and biomarker research studies, looking at how the neuronal cells are performing. These are all things that are going to help us describe a more effective, efficient, and hopefully cost-efficient system of caring for these patients, as well as defining more effectively their prognosis so that we can plan for long-term surveillance, rehabilitation, reintegration in a more intelligent and effective manner.
We talked earlier about the levels of severity when it comes to brain injuries, and so using that as a context, let me ask a very simple layman's question about the thing, which is, do we see a day when we'll actually be able to cure brain injuries?
That's a very difficult question to answer. Obviously, we cure them with the effective vaccine and prevention, but when the injury occurs, will there be ways that we can control neuronal dysfunction, stimulate neuronal regeneration, reprogram neuronal circuitry? I think to some degree the answer to that question has to be a qualified yes. The timeline, however, remains to be seen, but when you look around you and you realize what we are beginning to understand about how cellular physiology, the human genome, and molecular biology actually work, then it becomes apparent that the more we become comfortable in understanding these areas, the better we'll be able to at least predict, if not manipulate, some of these cellular functions. So I think the answer has to be an unqualified yes, but don't expect it tomorrow.
Right. And to the other members on the panel, I mean, we were talking earlier about the severity or the levels of severity of brain injuries. You know, for someone listening to the program, I mean, can you give us just a very quick summary of what each of the levels means, or how one would, one of the injuries qualifies as a less severe injury than another one?
Well, we use the common classification system is mild, moderate, and severe in terms of quantifying a brain injury. It's based upon some medical measures, and what happens, all of us that are sort of all in the field practicing know that you might have a significant bang to the head. It might not render you unconscious, but you might end up with long-term psychological, cognitive, even psychiatric problems afterwards. So even though those medical designations of mild, moderate, and severe are good for Dr. Tepass and others to use, it doesn't necessarily translate into functioning. And that's why the example was given before, that even for people with so-called mild brain injury, especially children, we may be, one, underestimating the numbers, and two, underestimating what the needs and the deficits are from those kids. We certainly know in the NFL right now that concussion is a huge issue in terms of looking at these NFL athletes that are getting concussions, multiple concussions, and actually having to leave the sport by the time they get in their 40s and 50s, going into early dementia and Alzheimer's. But we have a lot of young kids playing sports in this country who get the proverbial thing to the head or the bang, and it might not knock them out, but what does it do to them? And that's a huge group of children that we are just beginning to start to recognize and start to treat better.
And it's not just football when you think about it, because, I mean, soccer, the children play with no helmets and things like that. So I don't know if it's ever practical to say the kids won't be playing sports anymore, but how do we,
Well, it's like Dr. Tepass said, and I sometimes get in a little trouble when I say things like this, but, when I take my granddaughters to the park, the amusement park, there's always this little wooden cardboard figure outside that says, if you aren't this high, you can't get on the ride. But we have children in this country that are playing contact football at ages 6, 7, and 8. The equipment never fits them. The helmets certainly never fit. And is that something that we need to look at differently? And even in soccer, even though sometimes people will talk about headbands, most soccer concussions are either head-to-head impact or head-to-ground impact. So we've started to take a more in-depth look at how children experience concussion and what kinds of sports. And one of the classic examples, I think, is cheerleading. Even though under Title IX, and we did a great job in terms of having equal sports for both sexes, cheerleading is not a sport under Title IX. It's an entertainment. So cheerleaders who end up, they're tossing themselves, they're falling, everything else, and getting hurt, we haven't even begun to put in some measures for them in terms of concussion baseline assessment.
And, I was wondering, given your position and the work you do as a research professor, if you could give us your perspective relative to where we are and where you think we're going.
Well, I was just going to add to what Ron was saying, that one of the things that happened, I'm not exactly sure when it happened. It may have been like in the 90s, but gymnastics was a big sport in across schools in America up until, I believe it was in the 90s, when somebody said, this is a dangerous sport, and schools could be held liable for any injuries that happen. So gymnastics stopped being covered in and being a school sport in many schools across the country, if not all of them. And lots of those kids went into cheerleading. So we do have lots and lots of injuries from cheerleading. It's boys football, it's girls soccer, it's basketball, it's cheerleading. And that's, you know, huge numbers of kids. So the under-recognition, the under-diagnosing from not just sports injuries, but obviously motor vehicle crashes and all the other ways kids hurt themselves, it's a very big problem.
And I'd like to use an example. You know, if you think in terms of those numbers, you know, which we've given out these millions of kids, but what if for every kid with a brain injury in this country, we had we turned down the Amber Alert light? I mean, you start talking about millions and millions of kids each year, and you think of how many every day and how many every hour, the Amber lights would be on 24/7 across this country. It's a silent epidemic that we have not been able to grab hold of yet and really shake out. And then, you know, sort of start to structure something around, which is why when Patrick Donohue brought together over 50 of us to really think and to develop a national plan, our pediatric-acquired brain injury plan, it's the first time ever in this country we've addressed this from a nationwide focus.
And that's actually a good point, because we've got to take another break, but when we come back, I do want to expand on that point some more, because the open source principle that Patrick discussed that started this is actually expanded now to where the work done by this foundation and, of course, many of the related activities are now more than just local. It's more than national. It's international. And, you know, brain injuries aren't just specific to the U.S. They're everywhere around the world. I want to talk about that some, and also talk a bit about the Zachary Leistedt Project when we come back. But before we go to the break, let me invite everyone listening to the program to join our team at Disabilities At. And also, please visit us on Facebook at Disabilities at Work. So we're going to take another break, and we'll be back to talk more about the situation regarding about brain injuries, both here and around the world, with this distinguished panel from the Sarah Jane Brain Foundation. I'm Ray Zardetto, and this is Disabilities at Work Radio.
The market's up or down, or if you're looking to improve your portfolio, our experts are ready to talk to you. Call now, toll free, 866-472-5790. That's 866-472-5790. Voice America Business Network. Disabilities at Work encourages people with disabilities, their families, and their supporters to patronize businesses that have earned the right to display the Disabilities at Work logo on wall plaques, window decals, or websites. By some estimates, people with disabilities control hundreds of millions of dollars in disposable income. They can use that spending power to send a message to corporate America. Become a Disabilities at Work business or a registered agency with the power to endorse supportive businesses at the Disabilities at Work website, www.disabilitiesatwork.org. From the boardroom to you, Voice America Business Network. You are listening to Disabilities at Work Radio. We welcome questions and comments from our listening audience, which you can send to us on Twitter at Disabilities At or on our Facebook site, Disabilities at Work. Also, visit disabilitiesatwork.org. Welcome back.
We're back on Voice America's Business Network. This is Disabilities at Work Radio, and I'm Ray Zardetto. Today's show is sponsored by the Kessler Foundation, which is dedicated to improving the lives of the disabled and does so through rehabilitation research done by the Kessler Foundation Research Center and through the work of the Kessler Program Center, which prepares the disabled for the demands of the workplace. And for more information, you can visit their website at www.kesslerfoundation.org. Also sponsoring our show today is the New Jersey Division of Disability Services, part of the State of New Jersey's Division of Human Services. And this division focuses on helping people who have become disabled as adults so they can live more independently in their communities. And Disabilities at Work Radio thanks both the Kessler Foundation and the New Jersey Division of Disability Services for their consideration in sponsoring this week's show. We're going to return to our discussion now about brain injuries. And again, our panel is Anne Glang, Ron Savage, Dr. Joseph Tipas, and Patrick Donohue. And I wanted to continue the discussion now with Patrick first, to discuss another related project to the Sarah Jane Brain Project, and it's the Zachary Leisted Project. And Patrick, why don't you fill us in on that?
Sure. Well, as Dr. Savage had mentioned before, sports-related concussions and brain injuries are obviously a huge subset of the 3 million new brain injuries that occur each year. And there was a young man in Washington State named Zachary Leisted, who was a 14-year-old star football player who had sustained a concussion playing football. He sat out for a little while, and then they put him back into the game. And on the last play of the game, he suffered a second impact, which has left him permanently disabled. And him and his family, very brave family, decided to take the situation and effect change. And what they did is they passed a law in Washington State. A similar measure was passed in Oregon called Max's Law, with the very simple core principles of that, number one, that parents and youth athletes and coaches have to be trained and educated about the risks associated with head injuries and concussions. Number two, that if there's a suspicion of a concussion or head injury, that that youth athlete has to be immediately removed from player practice. And the third piece is that they can't be put back into player practice until they've been medically evaluated by a licensed healthcare provider. Now, that what that may seem like, it's a fairly commonsensical law, and on top of that, the law they passed was budget neutral. But while there may be some guidelines out there, you know, in different areas, until they actually made it a law and did they see significant change in both Washington and Oregon. And so we partnered up in January, right at the start of the Super Bowl week, with the American College of Sports Medicine to initiate those core principles and legislation in all the remaining 47 other states, because Texas had a law in place as well, to implement these type of Zachary Leisted laws all over the country. And since then, there have been laws passed now in Rhode Island, Connecticut, Virginia, Oklahoma, New Mexico, and there's legislation moving through the different state legislatures in about another 15 or 20 other states around the country. So the idea of the Zachary Leisted Brain Project was to advance these core principles through legislation, through public awareness, and then increasing, you know, the research and understanding around these sports-related concussions and brain injuries.
Well, aren't these teams required to have a licensed physician at practices, at the games, to be there to look exactly for those kinds of situations?
Oh, absolutely not. I mean, many. You know, I think there's. I forget what the number is, but it might be upwards of 60% of high schools don't have athletic trainers at their sporting related events. So, I mean, it's a massive problem. And just to give you an anecdotal type of story, in Washington State, a few weeks after they initiated the law and they started training, there was a high school coach who, during a scrimmage, saw a kid get a ding and seemed just a little dizzy. And under normal circumstances, you know, the coach said that, you know, he would probably just sat the kid down for a little while and put him back in. But because he'd just been specifically trained around this, he sent the kid to the emergency room, and they found that he had a bleed on the brain. And under normal circumstances, if he'd gone back into that game, every doctor who saw him said if he'd gone back in and sustained another head injury, likelihood of permanent disability, if not death, would have been almost certain. So, I mean, these are things that are happening all over the country. And to put things, you know, a little bit more into perspective, you talk about the numbers in the previous segment. What happens here is that, you know, little Susie, little Johnny, they're playing soccer when they're 8 years old. They fall out of a tree and they get a concussion, and within a day or two they seem to be normal, happy-go-lucky, doing well in school, socializing again. But when all of a sudden they're in high school and using executive functioning of their brains, these kids are going from A students to C students, but they're being misdiagnosed as ADHD, behavioral problems, drug problems, family problems, when in fact it's the brain injury that they sustained 6 years earlier that was never tracked and treated properly. And just to give you one really staggering number, I think it was in Minnesota, the CDC did a study where upwards of 80% of the kids in our juvenile delinquency system have some form of a brain injury. 80%. Now, in Texas alone, there are 106,000 kids under 18 years of age in the juvenile delinquency system. So that means you have 50, 60, 70, 80,000 kids that are going through this juvenile delinquency system that are not being tracked and treated with a brain injury, and then they're being dumped into an adult system, and we wonder why there's such a high recidivism rate of crime. I mean, this is literally a public health crisis that's going on out there, and you know, I truly believe that the Zachary Leistat laws are going to really help raise awareness and understanding across the board dealing with these type of concussions and brain injuries.
And I think probably one of the most important facets to discuss now would be how, I mean, first of all, the idea of the brain injuries, you know, and the massive problem, as you called it, is not limited to just the United States, right? This is a worldwide phenomenon, I would assume. And so, you know, how important is it that we link up with, you know, doctors and researchers and experts in other countries on other continents to work this?
Can I, well, if Dr. I could just start that off, I had the good fortune with Dr. Jane Gillette, who is a pediatric neurologist out of Canada, and we co-founded the International Pediatric Brain Injury Society. And we now have representatives from 80 different countries, because many of us that have had the experience, like everyone on the panel here, to work with colleagues in other countries, we have the same discussions. A large number of kids that are injured, here's how they're injured. Some countries it differs. For example, in India, a lot of 10 to 16-year-old boys suffer brain injuries from falls because they are doing a lot of labor and going up into high-rise buildings and bringing the materials to the men that are constructing the buildings, and these kids fall. So every country, these kids get brain injuries in a different way, but we're all saying the same thing. And one of the things I think that's critical to bring into the show that we're finding is from the, we mentioned the research before, is the longitudinal studies. We have a number of longitudinal studies in the States and other countries that have looked at kids over 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 years. And what we're finding is that injury, that early injury to a developing brain, of, you know, a child's brain is still in development up until their, you know, their early 20s, that an injury to a developing brain can have lifetime consequences. And so now, as we're looking at this from an international perspective, and we're getting more people involved in our pediatric acquired brain injury plan from other countries, it's in a nutshell, we're all sort of seeing the same thing. Even though our kids may be injured differently, this brain injury can have a lifetime consequences for that child and that family.
All right, well, this is a fascinating discussion, and I want to continue it, but we have to take one more break. And when we come back, a few more questions about both the foundation, about brain injuries, and what people who are listening to the show today can do to help. So, ladies and gentlemen, stay with us. I'm Ray Zardetto, and this is Disabilities at Work Radio.
We're always talking business.
Talk to an expert.
Call now, toll free, 866-472-5790. That's 866-472-5790. Voice America Business Network. Disabilities at Work encourages people with disabilities, their families, and their supporters to patronize businesses that have earned the right to display the Disabilities at Work logo on wall plaques, window decals, or websites. By some estimates, people with disabilities control hundreds of millions of dollars in disposable income. They can use that spending power to send a message to corporate America. Become a Disabilities at Work business or a registered agency with the power to endorse supportive businesses at the Disabilities at Work website, www.disabilitiesatwork.org.
The business community's first choice in Internet Talk Radio, Voice America Business Network.
You are listening to Disabilities at Work Radio. We welcome questions and comments from our listening audience, which you can send to us on Twitter at Disabilities At or on our Facebook site, Disabilities at Work. Also, visit disabilitiesatwork.org. Welcome back.
Welcome back to Disabilities at Work Radio. And remember that Disabilities at Work can be heard each Wednesday at noon Eastern Time on Voice America's Business Network. I'd like to get right back into our discussion about brain injury and what's being done about it, what can be done about it with our panel. And I'd like to start by asking, Pat had ended the last segment talking about sometimes the misidentification or lack of diagnosis in the case of suspected brain trauma or injury, and I thought maybe you'd want to pick up on that point a little bit.
Yes, and I think the numbers really speak to that. In 2008, there was a study by CDC. The author was Zaloshna, and they found, or they estimate, that there's about 135,000 children and youth ages 5 to 19 who have a disability from traumatic brain injury. But if you look at where those kids are served, as I said before, those kids are in school. They're in your classrooms across America today. And if you look at our special education system, that is the our special education system, that is the our special education.